Welcome to Patriot's Lament right here on KFAR. We are a local talk radio, and for the next hour, we are going to be talking about issues that have to do with liberty, how we've lost it, what we can do to get it back. Hopefully, we'll give you at least one action point sometime today, something that you personally can do, whether it is something as relatively simple as reading a particular author or an article that we may recommend, something that'll get you thinking. It might be a particular person to call or write a letter to. We're going to try to make sure that we are passing on not just information, but also some valuable ways in which you can, basically help fight for liberty right where you are, whatever it is that you're doing for your livelihood. I'm Steve Floyd, the man behind the machine here, or monkey, I should say, behind the machine. Joining me in the studio from the Fairbanks Campaign for Liberty, Dave Giesel. Good morning, Dave.
Morning, Steve.
And also to his right, my left, it's Josh Bennett, one of the owners of Big Horn Enterprises. Good morning, Josh.
Morning, Steve.
And, of course, Big Horn Enterprises, one of the big sponsors of the show for all of your trucking and construction needs. Call Big Horn Enterprises at 451-7310. Now that our sponsorship liners are out of the way here, gentlemen, is there any new taxes we'd like to promote this week, perhaps? Another week goes by. There's got to be another new tax proposed by somebody, right?
Yeah, well, it was proposed, and then there was so much backlash that it ended up getting pulled back. But there was a proposed Christmas tree tax this week.
Oh, wow.
Which
I heard about that, yeah.
Which is, it's interesting from a couple angles. It was going to be 15 cents a tree, and its purpose was so they could promote the sales of real trees, because artificial trees have been cutting into real tree sales. And so instead of the real tree growers, you know, getting together and deciding to have their own ad campaign, this was going to be done through Department of Agriculture, I think. They were going to levy the 15-cent tax to pool the money and do it. So interesting from a couple angles. One, most of the people who I spoke to about it and who my friends spoke to about it were like, oh, it's only 15 cents. What's the big deal? But apparently there was enough public backlash that they nixed it anyway. The other thing that's interesting is this was not done by law. This was done by regulation. This was Department of Agriculture implementing a tax, right? Not the Treasury, not the IRS, you know, through Congress.
Yeah, that's probably the most significant part of it.
Straight up bureaucratic, you know, legislation, basically.
Well, we've virtually made Congress irrelevant now anyway, and it's not, you know, people who get all up in Obama's grill about that, it kind of bothers me, because it's not President Obama who has made Congress irrelevant. Congress has made Congress irrelevant, and Congress made itself irrelevant, oh gosh, I don't know, maybe under the first Bush administration, maybe even under Reagan. I mean,
maybe
it
like
has been
years ago.
Yeah. It has been a long time that Congress has pretty much been ceding all of its constitutional authority to other branches of government. It's been ceding its authority to the executive branch, with the whole way in which, I mean, how many executive orders have we had in the last week?
Yeah, you were saying something like 50.
I was exaggerating. That was hyperbole. I don't know if we actually had 50 executive orders, but I know that it seems like every single day we have at least one new executive order.
Yeah, and they renew all the old ones, too.
And which means basically that the president is legislating. He's issuing laws by decree. There's no debate. There's no vote. There's no process. It's just simply, I think there should be a new rule, and therefore I'm going to make one, and you all will follow it because it is an executive order, the president says. So, okay, so you've got that. That's been going on for a long time. When was it that Congress ceded its war powers? Was it under Truman?
Well, it would have been back all the way to
Korea.
So under Truman then, right?
Yeah.
So we've had Congress basically giving away its powers to the executive branch, but it's also Congress has also been giving away its powers to the judicial branch. I mean, how often do we see bad laws enacted by Congress? They know full well that those laws are going to get struck down by the Supreme Court, and yet they advance them anyway to make some kind of political point.
The same as with Congress and the budget. I laugh all the time when Republicans get up and say, I'm still waiting for the President of the United States to show us a budget. You know, not his job. It specifically says in the Constitution that Congress shall present a budget, and they pass it off. I mean, they're not the only ones that are irrelevant. We heard here last Tuesday, Steve, I think we finally nailed down that our whole state government is worthless. Why do we even have it? We kind of talked about the other, I don't know, it was last week or the week before. We can save a lot of money just shutting the whole industry down. And it is an industry. Shut down Juneau completely. Just let the feds have it. They have it anyways.
Well, and the more, you know, the more streamlined we get as a government and the more things that we keep on, that the Congress, I want to stress again that the Congress keeps suggesting ways that we can streamline things to basically cut out the middleman. Let's just be more effective. Let's stop debating. The time for debate is over. We need action. Let's just go ahead and let the president do what he thinks is best.
Well, that raises a whole nother interesting point, which is the drive for efficiency in government, which is certainly a Republican rally point, is they want an efficient government.
Which is an oxymoron, isn't it?
Well, do you really?
Yeah.
What does government
do?
Do
you really? With all the stuff they do to you, do you want them to do it efficiently?
Real quick, George Washington had a quote about government that I love. He said that it's like fire. It is a fearful... How does it go?
Fearful servant and a dreadful master, something like that.
Yeah, it's dangerous like fire. Government is dangerous like fire. If you try to use government as a servant, then it is going to get out of control, and it is going to destroy stuff. If you try to serve government as your master, you will be destroyed in the process. I mean, George Washington, our first president, warned us of this, and they offered him kingship. He turned it down. He walked away. And yet, how many presidents since then have been trying to gather more powers to the presidency, and not just simply them as individuals, but to the office of the presidency. And then anyone who dares to question whether or not the president, and it doesn't matter which party he is, you get accused of being unpatriotic. You get accused of being anti-American. You get accused basically of being an anarchist.
Anti-American.
It's a compliment. Well, yeah, the only thing that George Washington is wrong about is fire has useful purposes. And government doesn't, you know, government is not necessary. That was the only thing he was mistaken about.
Well, and, you know, and the argument that you hear from people all the time about, well, we need government because of all the lawlessness. People would, if we didn't have laws, people would be lawless. People would run around killing each other all the time. There would be, I mean, look at Occupy Wall Street. This is a classic example of what happens when there are no laws. People just start raping each other in their tents and they start killing each other. You know, it's just like the tea parties, right? Oh, wait a second. No, it's not. That was Aaron, your brother, Aaron Bennett, and I had a really interesting discussion this week about the similarities between Occupy Wall Street and the tea parties, and we got some people really bent out of shape by suggesting that there's not a whole lot of difference. So one big difference did emerge this week, and that is the number of crimes that have been committed and that are continuing to be committed with the Occupy Wall Street movement. And not just things like petty larceny, but actual murder, rape. I mean, pretty big deal crimes that are being committed right there in the middle of the protest. So, I mean, there's a certain... I think there may be a certain amount of validity to the idea that we do need government to rein in lawlessness. How do you answer that, Dave?
Yeah. Who wages war?
Government wages war.
Right. So if you look at like the number of lives lost in the 20th century, you know, it's in the hundreds of millions from war. How many people were murdered by somebody who wasn't in a costume in the 20th century?
I don't know. Probably far, far fewer
times less. Right. How much rape happens at the end of, you know, World War One, World War Two, Vietnam, Korea, just to talk about the little adventures the U.S. was in, a lot more than happen by private citizens, not in a costume. I mean, government is the institutionalization of crime, and its agents are immune.
The government is criminal in itself. I mean, we have all kinds of supposed laws that are supposed to restrict government, and they break that on a continual basis. They can pass another law to make it so they're correct. But all in all, they're the lawlessness. They are lawless. They're the ones that... Whoa, Special guest.
Hey, welcome. just walking in from far north Tactical, we've got Aaron Bennett in the house now as well. Good morning, Aaron. How are you?
Morning, Steve.
Thanks for joining us. We're talking right now about how, generally speaking, we see government that is gathering to itself more power, and the powers that are constitutionally attributed to government, and really restricted, I guess you should say, by the Constitution, those powers are being expanded, which means the Constitution is being broken, and the branches that are supposed to have particular powers are yielding those powers to branches that aren't supposed to have them. I mean, right now I think that the judicial branch is overweighted, when basically we have judges that are issuing laws from the bench without going through the process of debate, without going through the process of actually weighing the constitutionality, although technically that's what they're supposed to do.
Interpretation's being done by executive order, too.
Yeah, exactly.
That was something that good old Junior started doing.
Yeah.
And John Woo, who was up here, who is an evil dude, he was one of the first ones who suggested that be done to allow for torture. He's like, well, we'll just issue an executive order that says this part of the Patriot Act be interpreted this way and this part be interpreted that way, and we will, you know, we'll instruct how these laws will be enforced.
May I just throw out for my Republican friends, who, by the way, I've not yet ever heard a Democrat, and there might be some out there, but I've never heard a Democrat justify torture, but I have heard plenty of Republicans justify torture. May I just throw out, as one who was an interrogator, I mean, that was my job. I was an interrogator for the U.S. Army. Not only was I forbidden from using torture under the Geneva Conventions and the other laws applicable to the U.S. Armed Forces at the time, but I found from experience when talking to other people that torture is very ineffective when it comes to actually getting good intelligence. All you ever get out of torture is what the person thinks you want to hear. That is it. Yeah. So if you go, and that is really, really bad questioning. I mean, if you go into a room and you start asking someone leading questions, that's a bad interrogation technique. And if you start asking them in a line of questioning that leads them in a particular way, you're leading them to the answer that you obviously want to get, then you're completely ignoring the truth. And when
since when has the government been concerned with the truth?
I'd like to think that when I was an interrogator for the government, that I was concerned for the truth as an individual.
You were.
They
weren't. There were much bigger agendas at work, as I'm sure you're aware.
No, I am aware. So, I mean, there were a couple of reports that I sent up, one in particular in which we gave a detailed report on observations made of weapons training that was going on, in which obviously Muslim warriors were being trained by an American on the use of weapons systems, and that was the only report I've ever had kicked back, the night in which I was instructed, you did not see this. Not only was I quite clear that I did see this, I had a very detailed report of what I saw, and to get it kicked back from a higher-up saying, no, I did not see that, obviously there were other agendas at work, so I yield the point. I see what you're saying. Anyway, so now we've got torture on the table, we've got a complete breakdown. Yeah, you know, people who say, well, we need government in order to have the laws to keep people from breaking laws is an oxymoron, because the only
the only people who get an exception to that are the enforcers, right? I mean, if you want to talk about, you know, all these rights, you know, right to privacy, right to be secure in your person and property, all these things, in order to enforce most of these laws that we're told are necessary, you have to give somebody a pass on them applying, on the laws applying to them.
Classic example, just if you doubt that in your mind, classic example. What happens when a police officer goes to pursue a suspect? Does he have to obey the speed limit signs? Does he have to obey traffic signs like stop signs or traffic lights? Does he have to, even when he catches up with the criminal, to get that person out of the car? I mean, you're going to see basically assault. You're going to see...
Well, there is... Yeah, I mean, you can, you know, like if they want to search your car, you know, you can say, I don't consent to a search. And that's great. unless you get, you know, pulled out of the car and tased or whatever. And then, but then if and that happens, you know, then you can go to court if you survive the conflict. But the point is, if you did it as a private individual, if you did those kind of things, if you behaved in the same way that the enforcers behave in order to do their job, quote unquote, you'd be in jail. Like, no ifs, ands, or buts. Nobody in society as we live in it today would find that behavior acceptable unless you had the right costume on. You put the right costume on and nobody's going to say a peep. Right? You go in front of a judge and you lie and you get put in jail for... for perjury. You go in front of a jail in the right costume and lie, and somebody gets convicted of a crime they didn't do because you have authority.
TSA, prime example.
Yeah, that is, you know,
you'd
and
go
people,
to jail if you did anything
that the TSA is doing. Let's say that I wanted to search a child. Holy smokes. Look what happened with Penn State.
Yeah.
This week. Did he do anything? The guy that's accused. I mean,
man, now there's a good defense. He should use the TSA defense.
He was just making sure that the children coming into the stadium were not terrorists.
Yeah, didn't have a bomb or anything, you know.
All right, 458 talk is the number. Shall we go to the phones? Good morning, caller. Who's this?
Good morning, this is Brian.
Good morning, Brian. Welcome to Patriots Lament. What's on your mind?
I'm totally hip to you guys' jive. I understand what you're saying, and I agree pretty much. Government is evil by nature, and it likes to absorb our rights. But the one thing I will tell you is, in my travels around the world, especially in the very corrupt third world countries, you as an individual are responsible for enforcing your rights and making sure you have those rights. And in the United States, we're a little bit naive as to the nature of humans. I think in a lot of ways we've been sort of protected from what real evil looks like. And what we used to do, even in the 60s when I was a kid, if you did something wrong to somebody's sister, for example, they didn't really have to worry too much about the police. It was her dad and her brothers and her uncles that were going to come and get you. And so I've always been of the mind, yes, it would be nice to have our rights enshrined in a document that was held as holy, and it would be nice to have the government looking out for those rights, but that's actually a very rare circumstance to find yourself in. Most of the time in history and most of the places in the world, that is really not the case, and you as an individual are really responsible for making sure that those rights are not violated, and when they are, then you have to put people on notice that they can't do that again.
How different are we now in the United States? I mean, you mentioned like when you were a child or whatnot in terms of the way that we used to be able to depend on the police to help protect our rights. We used to be able to depend on our elected officials to stand up for our rights. Now it seems like to me, and maybe I'm just getting cynical here, but it seems to me like almost every single one of our elected officials is corrupt, is on the take, is in it for their own...
The reason for that is because we've put our Bibles away. We've stopped going to church. We're closing churches at a record pace in the United States. People are buying them and making them into houses, and we've completely lost our moral foundation. And that's really, if you want to dig through all the baloney, that's where it starts. An upright, righteous Christian individual wouldn't be corruptible. And it's such an unusual thing nowadays to find an individual who is not corruptible with power, money, or both, that people don't believe that that situation could exist. But it did. For 150, 200 years in this country, we had the vast majority of the people in the population were Christian, and they were upright people. Many of them were actually what I would consider righteous, and that's the difference. Is we've fallen away from our God, our principles, our beliefs, our morals, our values, and we are really adrift socially as a nation, and we're suffering the consequences of that. And it's a generational thing. It is not going to come back unless we have a real bad economic situation, much worse than what we had in the 70s. And we're not there yet. People are not. hungry. People are not going without. Everybody says, oh, the economy is so bad. Well, we don't have people starving to death in this country. We don't have that many people who are homeless other than folks that are mentally ill or something like that. We do still have it very good here. We live like kings compared to most people in the world. And as a result, we don't really feel like we need to rely on God. And I think that's where it all stems from.
The state has become God. I mean, even to today's Christians, the state is God. The state,
well, that's
asks,
true,
the
that's
Christians
why they
today
have...
ask the state constantly to pass laws for them, to make people holy, constantly.
You're absolutely right that the state cannot tolerate real competition from an actual God. That's why communists and socialists and the Nazis, you know, well, they're socialists also, but fascists, anybody that has a totalitarian dictatorship type government is going to make it illegal for you to worship a God, because that's direct competition for people's souls. And, you know, Hitler said in the 30s, he goes, you got a choice. You can either be German or you can be a Christian, but you can't be both. And you see that time and time again. Anytime there's a totalitarian state or a totalitarian individual, they're not Christians, and they do not tolerate Christianity.
Well, how does a totalitarian individual come to power, though? Isn't it because people yield their own individual, like you were saying about that individual sense of righteousness? Doesn't it happen when an individual goes to the state and says, I need you to come and enforce my will on my neighbor? I don't like the way my neighbor is living. I need you to enforce a law against him. And then we get enough people together to come in and ask the government to do something, and they feel compelled. They have to pass a law.
This is sort of a snowballing. It's like there was an engine built in the 50s called the scramjet. The faster it would go, the faster it could go. The more air it got, the faster it could go. And this is the way government regulation and government law is. The more regulations they make, the more corrupt people become, the more regulations they have to make, and it's somewhat of an exponential situation.
Right, that's exactly the point. The point is America's freedom is only skin deep. We appear to be more free than a place like China or Philippines or any other place like that, when in fact that's not even the case. We're more free in one sense only, that the totalitarianism of our government isn't oppressive to the point where they murder people that cross them. But in everyday life, through bureaucracy, in every aspect of your life, you're much more free in other countries.
Taxation.
The freedom is. I will just reinforce what I said before. You're right. As on the books and what's enforced, we do have less and less freedom here, and in some cases less than other countries. But I have always maintained, no matter where I've been in the world, my freedom was my own responsibility. And how free I felt was a personal thing.
Good point.
6:60 a.m. You can hear the difference.
Fox News Radio, I'm Lillian Wu. The 10th debate for GOP presidential candidates being held in a key primary state, South Carolina, with foreign policy the name of the game tonight.
Mitt Romney finds himself atop the polls and under attack. Foreign policy isn't exactly one of his strong suits, but he'll focus on international economics instead.
Fox's Carl Cameron says as for Herman Cain,
he needs to get that sexual harassment allegation from years ago behind him. Rick Perry had a disastrous debate in Michigan last week. He needs to overcome his own gaffes. And then there's Newt Gingrich, who's been surging in the polls and has encyclopedic command of international affairs issues. And don't rule out Michelle Bachmann standing out tonight as a member of the Intelligence Committee.
And at Penn State,
we love our team. We support our team entirely.
Fans turning out as their team takes on Nebraska in the first football game in decades without Joe Paterno at the helm, ousted for his handling of a child sex abuse scandal. Fox News, we report, you decide.
There will be no turning back.
These are difficult times. These are challenging times for our country.
What happens here in 2011 happens here.
Issues and problems that we're facing now, there's still hope.
Local Talk Radio, KFAR, 660 AM.
Man, he called him out. I owe harassing my spouse. Gotta park my truck on another block, cause the subprime loan got my ass in hock. Got a couple good friends with helping hands. I need a brand new job with a healthcare plan. They closed the plan, they stole my job and told me crime don't pay unless you ask the mob. So I smoke a little crack, drink a little wine, watch a little too, try to kill a little time. Every single day I'm about a little more behind, but I'm paying it no mind. It'll all be fine. I get by.
Welcome back to Patriots Lament right here on KFAR. We're just trying to get by here and help you to find a way to get by as well. You know, that last caller, very, very good points that he made. You know, one of the things we were talking during the break about how he mentioned taking care of your own rights, especially in the third world. What would happen if you did that here in the United States?
He brought up, you know, if someone violated your sister, you weren't worried about the cops. You were worried about the brothers or the dad hunting you down. Well, what if you do that today? Someone violates your sister, you go and take care of business, you're going down. They're going to come get you. So there's a point to where you say that our rights are our own. You have to point them out. You have to stand up for your own rights. But the problem is the government that we have has taken that away. You will not stand up for your rights. You won't stand up for your neighbor's rights. You will not be belligerent about your rights. We are here to take care of you. Go home, shut the door, shut up, and obey us. That's what it comes down to. You don't have the right here. I mean, you may say you can feel as free as you want when you're sitting in a jail cell. You're still not free. I mean, you can promote your rights and say, I have the right to do this, I have the right to do that. They'll throw you in jail. I have the right to protect my family. They'll throw you in jail. I have the right to whatever. Just name one thing that you say you have the right to, and I would find a law that says, no, you do not. And they will throw you in jail. And then you can be as free as you want in jail. That's what it comes down to. That's where we are here today. I mean, at least in third world countries, they're usually, some third world countries at least, they're so corrupt, their governments are so corrupt, but they're also inept. They can't do anything. People are a lot more free in third world countries because the government isn't big enough to overpower and be a part of everything in their life, where we have the exact opposite here.
So, Josh, so are you saying that the reason America is the most free place on earth is because we have the most people in prison?
Yes, we do.
Yeah, we do.
That is an interesting point and true, too. If you doubt that, look up the statistics, how many people that we have, not just in terms of the proportion, but the actual sheer numbers of our citizens.
By numbers, right? By numbers. Jeff Berwick has an article on lourockwell.com. It was either today or yesterday. I'll link it up on the blog after the show. And he pointed that out. He took all of the, you know, free democracies of the world and put them on a chart. And the U.S. has 800 people per 100,000 in prison. And the next closest, democratic government country, whatever, has 200. That's one-fourth. I mean, we have four times among the free world, the prison population. He showed a chart. It all kicked off in 1980. Until 1980, the prison population there's like 200 people per 100,000 people. And in 1980, when you start getting into all the moral wars waged by the state, not by, you know, like the previous caller said, the churches or the society self-enforcing, you know, ethics and morals, but by the state, then you started institutionalizing people for you know, bad behavior that didn't necessarily harm anyone. And you see the graph go from flat, just like, you know, up at like a 45-degree angle from 200 people per 100,000 to 800 people per 100,000.
And this is a classic example of what we were talking about earlier in terms of people trying to enforce their own personal morality on others. You know, where do those anti-drug and laws come from? And it's the same place that the anti-alcohol people came from back in the 1880s. Isn't that when the prohibition movement really got underway? And if you look at the history of prohibition and how progressive an idea that was, you know, the same people that got us into the Spanish-American War and the same people that got us into World War One, the same people who basically provoked the Great Depression.
Yeah, you know, that's something I don't understand is you're talking about the Spanish-American War, World War One, the great progressive presidents. There's three of them. There's Lincoln, there's Wilson, and there's FDR. Lincoln was responsible for the Civil War, which was the bloodiest war in American history. Wilson was responsible for entry into World War One. He ran under the campaign slogan, "He kept us out of war," for his second term. And as soon as he got reelected, he took the U.S. into World War One, hugely unpopular at the time. And FDR was responsible for taking the U.S. into World War Two by ignoring the Japanese ships steaming towards Hawaii for a week. And so it's interesting that the progressive presidents are the ones responsible for the greatest loss of American life in war, and the progressive movement is self-styled as a anti-war movement. It's also interesting now that the conservative movement beats the drum for war nonstop now, and it was the conservative type, you know, it was the classical liberal type congressmen and senators who, during those periods, Lincoln, Wilson, and FDR opposed entry to war.
Today, it's the religious right that beats the drums.
Which it was the right. Well, the so-called religious right. It's interesting because the drum beating for the war, the Spanish-American War, and World War One, was done by the Christian Socialist Movement, which is where the Pledge of Allegiance comes from. It was actually the same guy. It was Francis Bellamy, along with John Dewey, who's the founder of the modern education system. They worked very closely together to push this idea that we needed to spread democracy around the world and spread our morals through force. And it was because they believed in creating a socialist world. That was their goal, and that's why the pledge was written. The pledge was written to start planting the seeds of socialist thought in basically Boy Scouts' minds, and was created to sell a bunch more flags.
And yet, if you question the idea of saying the Pledge of Allegiance, you are going to get ripped up one side and down the other, as we have on this radio show, specifically for questioning the Pledge of Allegiance. Have
right,
you,
so go on,
to the
you know,
words.
Go on Wikipedia.
Read the words.
Go on Wikipedia and read the history of it, and read about the guy who came up with it. You know, there's a lot of people out there who know about John Dewey. Some do, some don't. He actually talked about the goal of the education system was to make good workers and make people who are compliant. If you read through his writings, he goes into that specifically. And he's working with this guy, this Christian socialist who wants to create a socialist utopia in the U.S., and they come up with the pledge, among other things. They were the intellectual leaders who took the U.S. into World War One too. But that's the history of the pledge, right? And now it's just, you know, just
now we've come so far, we see the pledge in church.
Something we'd run with, right? Which is
not
interesting to your point. You know, that the state has replaced God. I mean, you still have the building. And the little cross out front, whatever that means, I don't know. It's not a flag, so I don't know what it means. And you go inside, and there's the pledge and the battle hymn of the Republic, and American flags up on stage, and all this jingoistic nonsense that gets spewed. Nothing about love your neighbor, you know.
Well, with a stick. Love him with a stick.
Right. But, yeah, and, you know, and what was Jesus a U.S. citizen, you know? I don't know. I think
he was a good American.
I think he lived in, you know, in a different part of the world, even.
Yeah, right. The Middle East?
Right, that's the thing, is Dave, Iraqis and Afghanis are not our neighbors.
Right, apparently not.
So we don't have to love them, is that what you're saying, Aaron? All right, four
or
five.
Do we have to go through the Good Samaritan story? Yeah. I mean, do they teach that one anymore?
They do in our church. I don't know if you guys have ever been, if you've ever visited, but you certainly will hear the actual story of the Good Samaritan in some churches. And yet, you know, what does it mean to people to the idea that your neighbor is anyone in need? regardless of what their political or their racial or their national background is. You know, and they're right now, who is your neighbor? Ask yourself that question. There's a great action point for you.
Anyone that's a Republican?
A Republican? Is there a Democrat, actually, depending on what your personal...
No, that goes to an interesting point. There's these things called ego boundaries, which only exist in our mind, and we treat them like property boundaries. So you have some ideology or some idea, and whenever you come up with somebody who challenges that idea, you tend to react just as strongly as if they'd actually violated your physical boundary.
Mm, that's a good point.
And we get so tied up with those, we get so wrapped around those, that, yeah, we forget who our neighbor is. You know, our neighbor is whoever agrees with us. Screw everybody else. you know, very biblical line of thought.
Right? All four lines are on hold, gentlemen. Shall we go to the phones? 458 Tonka is the number. Thanks for your patience. Who's this?
Hi, it's Cecily.
Hi, Cecily. Are you my neighbor?
Yes.
Good. Thanks for calling in. What's on your mind today?
Oh, I was just thinking, yesterday I realized that maybe there are a lot of our Army, Navy, Marines, you know, the people protecting the Constitution of the United States of America and Alaska, maybe they don't even know what they're fighting for. And so, you know, it occurred to me that gentleman who had 8 years, he didn't realize that that's what he was fighting for in the Army, even though, I mean, he was duped into believing that, but he didn't even know that which he was duped into.
You know, it's interesting, Cecily, when you actually join the armed forces, you have to swear allegiance to the Constitution. You take an oath to support and defend the Constitution. Not every American citizen has to do that. And, you know, it's interesting to me, you know, when you talk about fighting for the Constitution, technically every single person in the armed forces is. The question then becomes whether or not the law or whether or not the orders that they're given are lawful orders, sending them into places where they are not actually supporting or defending the Constitution, but are actually working by their very actions to abrogate it.
My other thing was, I'm pretty sure that the troopers and the police are pretty confused as to what law to uphold now, that if they have to stand guard while one man robs another man, and then they chase over this guy who got robbed, or, you know, what laws are there if they're no longer, you know, the Constitution? Are they also sworn to uphold the Constitution, the police?
I believe they are.
Yeah.
And
they
so
are.
When
their job is to protect the state. I mean, there's no other.
Just
there's
the
no
state.
Other way
they,
to say
they,
it.
They're not about the Constitution, though.
No. Uh-huh. They're not. They're about protecting the state.
So
that's
then,
it.
What the course is? What then? What course do we have to protect ourselves? Except, you know, be a hole up in our houses and wait for them to come down and take it away.
We have none. I mean, that's really. I don't know why we're so wrapped up in our Second Amendment and revolution and this and that, whatever, and police officers upholding the Constitution, representatives upholding the Constitution, whatever. It's not going to happen. They're not going to do it. They're there to protect the state. They're there to promote the state. That's it.
And you know, for the people who are concerned that, well, you know what, when it comes down to it, if the police or the military are given an unlawful order, they've sworn an oath, and they will side with the Constitution. Who are they more loyal to?
No.
And look at what happened with Veterans Day yesterday. A person in uniform is far more loyal to another person in uniform. You said it great.
We were talking about that before the show.
So where your bread is buttered, pretty much.
Well, yeah, and you also have this. I mean, we have these tribal instincts just as humans, where we identify with people who look like us or do the same thing or whatever. So when you have somebody, you know, who works for an agency and they wear a certain costume. I mean, they're going to identify with and defend the other people who are wearing the same costume first, right? And then, yeah, and then where's their bread buttered, right? Where's their check coming from? And then somewhere down the line are, you know, the regular people, the mundanes, right? You and me. And so they're always going to look out for themselves first, which we all do anyway. I mean, we all do it. But that's worth considering. And so the conflict, you know, trying to make it a conflict between or viewing it as a conflict between, you know, us and the cops or something like that. That just serves to reinforce the conflict between the people in the costume and us. And so, I mean, that whole strategy is just it's how the struggle looks, but it just increases the conflict.
Cecily, thanks so much for the call. We're going to take another one here. Good morning. Welcome to Patriots Lament. Who's this?
Good morning.
Hey, who is this?
This is the Alaska Freedom Council.
Well, good morning, Alaska Freedom Council. Do you have a first name?
Yes, you can call me Mark Ames.
All right, good morning, Mark. What's on your mind?
Well, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty, the scriptures tell us.
Okay, I've heard that before.
And with these laws that are being lapuciously passed and promoted, freedom is going to naturally decline, and with it, the seizure of your resources, because that's really what's behind it. The resources. The mines and mining section 28A1, 90% where Alaska is concerned, the 90-10, that's been dwindled down to 20% when those born in Alaska or living here from elsewhere, citizens of Alaska, they don't even know where or what the 90-10 is applicable to.
All right, Mark, I appreciate that point of view. Gentlemen, Josh, Dave, how do the resources actually tie into this? Is it a matter of just a play to get our stuff? Is that what's going on with the government?
We are the resource.
Yeah.
The citizen is the resource. I mean, your labor is their resource that they're after. Your wealth is the resource that they're after. I mean,
if we didn't have money to give them for taxes,
well,
then
it's a lot harder to go drill a hole and find oil than it is to tax someone. It's a lot harder to go dig a hole and find gold, silver, copper, whatever you want.
You know, the nice thing about milk cows is that whenever they're done giving milk, you can eat them.
Beef cows.
That's right. 458 Talk is the number. Good morning, caller. Who's this?
This is Randy.
Good morning, Randy. Thanks for calling. What's on your mind today?
Well, I have a clipping in my hand from the Fairbanks Daily News Miner from February 13th, 2007.
You going to read it to us?
No, just the first sentence. The title is Burglary, Forgery Ring Cracked. And the first sentence says, four Fairbanksans were indicted late last week on dozens of charges of theft, burglary, and forgery. The indictments cracked open a case Fairbanks police have been investigating for months. Anyway, I was just thinking one step toward the direction of no government would be to immediately disband the Fairbanks police, the North Pole police, and the troopers. So I was going to ask the guests there, what if we did that and we had a rash of burglaries, forgeries, and so forth going on, how would it work? Would we hire the Pinkerton police?
We have a group that steals from actually everybody in the borough every year. They meet in a building across the river every 2 weeks. We have a massive forgery scheme called the Federal Reserve. They are immune by law from prosecution for counterfeiting. These institutions commit far more of these crimes, Randy.
Yeah, than any.
No, this is reality.
I appreciate
this.
You don't.
But this is reality.
I do appreciate
it. And they commit it on a scale much larger. I mean, the Federal Reserve counterfeited trillions of dollars last year. Trillions. You know how much copy paper that would take?
Yeah, I mean,
you'd have every Kinko's in the country running nonstop for like 6 months, right? I mean, we'd probably run out of cotton. So the institutionalization of these crimes in the state, which is granted immunity from them, is a far greater ill than bad people, right? And bad people will exist in any society. There's not going to be some utopia where everybody's good. The question is, do you take antisocial negative behavior and institutionalize it by granting people immunity, or do you allow responsibility to be placed on the individual?
Yeah, one thing too, just an observation, it's been my experience, and you may have seen it too, Randy, and the gentleman here in the studio, is that generally poor decision makers are aided in not making those poor decisions when they actually have a consequence to what their poor decision is. So in other words, if the person who's going to commit the burglary has a realistic fear that he might be shot dead by the homeowner, he's going to be less likely to go out and commit the burglary in the first place than if he thinks that the worst thing that's going to happen to him is that he might have to serve a couple of years in a place where he gets free food and free gym and free TV and free library privileges. Just an idea.
Well, and they also were looking into it for months, right?
Right.
So they had been committing the crimes for months. So they didn't actually deter or stop the crimes.
Well, and the what the... the reason the homeowners don't take care of business now, take care of themselves, is because the sanctified criminals will come and throw them in jail.
Exactly. You get prosecuted for defending your castle.
And, you know, I'm really happy that these guys, 4 years ago, figured something out after several months. But I know a guy that just was released from this institution here just a couple weeks ago. We all do here in this room. And I bet he would not mind at all if there were no police departments. Because while they might have been doing something good over here, they violated someone else that we know personally. For 8 months, he was violated. And he still is now, because he's not free.
Well, and what happened to his job? I mean, how do you maintain
house,
a...
Gone.
Yeah.
His family, they're not gone, but they're never get that 8 months back. So who cares?
Thanks, Randy. Appreciate your phone call. 458-TALK is the number.
Can I go one other direction with that?
Sure.
So if you lock somebody up, right, they're going to cost like $40,000 to $60,000 a year. And presumably somebody becomes a criminal or, you know, steals or counterfeits or whatever because they're short on money, right? They're trying to make ends meet, and they either can't get a job or they don't want to get a job or something like that. So the solution is to lock them in a cage where they're completely unproductive at an expense of $40,000 to $60,000 a year. Why not just give them the $40,000 to $60,000 a year and not put them in jail? And I don't believe in that because you'd have to steal the $40,000 or $60,000 to do it first. But right, if you're gonna enshrine this institution of locking people in cages where they provide no benefit to society because they're removed from it, and where they just have a place to stew over, you know, who they're gonna get back at and hang out with other people in the same situation. If you're gonna spend that much money on it's not restitution or anything like that. I mean, it's vengeance. If you're going to spend that much money to put people in a cage, why not spend, you know, a little pittance of that to prevent that from happening? I mean, you could literally just hand – it could be like a guy breaks into your house and you just hand him $40,000 and then you don't have to pay it in the taxes.
Which is part of the problem with the whole philosophy that says that crime comes from poverty or that crime comes from a social situation.
Crime comes from the state. I mean, we were talking about how many people, 800 per 100,000?
800 per 100 in the U.S.
Well, you probably could figure that 3/4 of those are in jail for victimless crimes.
88% of them are in jail for victimless crimes.
458-TALK is the number. You still there, caller?
Yeah, this is David.
Hey, David, what's on your mind?
Oh, I just wanted to maybe point out to people, because I've heard a lot of misconceptions about who the Antichrist is out of Revelations and Daniel. And John was real clear to people when he explained to them that the Antichrist is not a person, but rather a system of government. And he even named the five that came before him, Greece, Egypt, Mecca, Persia, and the one that was during his time, Rome. There was one that was to come later on, which we now know as to be Great Britain, and one where Britain had its head cut off, which was the system of the Antichrist at that time. And it was actually slain by Hitler, of all things, which is kind of ironic. But then out of the West would come a great power. This is out of Daniel. And that West was the United States, which would then at some point fall. And the United Nations, or a group of nations of 10, would rise up and start the one world nation and the one world religion. And the thing that people need to remember about this is... I mean, I agree with all this conservatism and everything, but honestly, I don't think it's going to do any good, because God said these things would happen for sure. There would be a one-world nation, and the United States of America is the only country left in the world standing in the way of that.
Except the United States of America is the one who came up with the idea for the League of Nations and the United Nations.
Exactly. Thanks for...
I don't exactly understand that line of thought. I've heard it. I grew up with that. I grew up believing that. And if you hold it up to reality, there's a bunch of holes in it that you find.
And the biggest problem I have with that is, and I've heard it, I grew up saying what Dave just said, believing the same thing. The biggest problem I have with it is that I hear, when being told that, taught that, whatever, I got the very same thing that guy just said. There's nothing you can do about it. It's going to happen. Well, guess why it happens?
Because nobody's doing anything
against
it.
Because no one does anything.
What does it take for evil to succeed?
For a Christian, I'm going to go a little religious here. Just the Christians here. Just because God is sovereign and things are going to happen does not negate your responsibility to do what's right. Just because something's going to happen doesn't mean that you are not responsible to oppose it. And, I mean, that's just for Christians there, but... I think that's the truth. The reason it happens is because Christians will not do anything because, well, it's going to happen. Well, the Bible doesn't give you the out to let it happen. God's sovereignty does not negate your responsibility.
And all people have felt like they were living in the end times. The apostles thought that they were living in the end times.
You know, it's interesting when you start talking about the religious perspective on a lot of these things. When you get into naming specific countries or naming specific people or naming specific times, I think it does remove an awful lot of personal responsibility away from you. Because if you know for a fact that the person that you're dealing with right now is not the Antichrist, then you don't, or if you think you know for a fact that he is, then how do you know whether or not you're supposed to oppose him? I mean, if you look at everything in Scripture that I see about evil being opposed, is that we are supposed to stand firm against evil. Now, that's not just simply an internal stand firm against evil in your own heart, although I think that's a big part of it. It's also, you know, you got to stand up against the guy who's trying to break into your neighbor's house. You got to stand up against the guy who's trying to make it illegal for your neighbor to make a living.
We're not taught that today, though. I mean, it's going to happen. That's what we're taught. So don't oppose it.
I was wrong about 88%. It's 90.7%.
Oh.
So he says, Jeff Berwick says, in 2008, he's talking about kidnapping and rampant in the U.S. And he says, in 2008, 182,422 individuals were either accosted by armed criminals or kidnapped. Right. And then he says of these people, 165,457 of them had not done anything violent to anybody.
All right. We've got less than a minute left. See if we can squeeze in one more phone call here just for kicks. Good morning, caller. Who's this?
Red.
Red, what's on your mind?
Hey, I hope the guy down in Anchorage that blow those two punks ass away that he walks free on this with no repercussions, you know.
I do, too. You're referring to the home invasion that happened early Thursday morning down there in Anchorage, where four people tried to break into the home. Two of them actually made their way in, held the guy at gunpoint, made him open his safe. And apparently, he had a loaded gun in his safe because he pulled it out, turned around, and shot the two of them.
That's cool.
Well, you know, that's I told my kids that story, and they're like, we need to get a safe so that we can put a loaded gun in it.
A message to all the punks out there and break into homes and stuff and burglarize. There might be somebody in the house there waiting for them, too.
Hey, thanks for the call. We are out of time. Patriots Lament online.
The punks in uniform or the ones?
PatriotsLament.blogspot.com.
All right. And Action Point again this week. Find out who is your neighbor. We will see you next time.
Talk radio for the interior. 660 AM. KFAR. Fairbanks.